Hi there. My name is Thomas. I'm representing Investment Excel today in this session where we will show how to apply the maximum likelihood estimation technique to obtain estimation of the parameters in the Vasicek process or in the Vasicek model. Please refer to some other sessions we have made on the Vasicek model if you'd like to know more on the theoretical framework, because in this session we will primarily focus on the estimation side. This video and the Excel workbook, including all VBA coding, are available at investmentexcel.com and spotify.com. But before moving on to the estimation technique, let's just briefly look at the theoretical underlyings of the Vasicek model. All relevant information for the Vasicek stochastic process is outlined in this upper left corner of the sheet. So the model was built in 1977 by Vasicek, and the starting point is a stochastic process, which is represented by this stochastic differential equation, where we see that the change in the short interest rate is governed by a drift and a diffusion. So the drift is a mean reverting drift, which means that the evolution of the short rate will never explode one way or another, just like in the random walk setting. It has a tendency to move upwards or downwards to the level of the mean reversion, which is represented by the parameter b, and the speed at which this convergence occurs is represented by a. So as usual, sigma is the degree of volatility and w is the Wiener process with a normal distribution of shocks. This SDE can be solved quite easily, at least if you are accustomed with stochastic analysis, on this formula here. And it looks ugly, but the important thing is that the only short rate that enters in the equation is R0, which is the observed short rate today. So all information of future short rates is inherited in the information of the short rate today, and this makes the model a one-factor Markov model. We can calculate the expected rate at a given time and the variance of the rate at a given time from the SDE solution, and what we see is that the mean is given by a condition on R0. So again, of course, no entrance of RT. So it is a conditional mean, but it's conditional only on the information today. The variance is 100% unconditional. Down here we have a discretionization, it's a very difficult word, of the continuous counterpart. This is used for econometric purposes, for estimation purposes, and from this discretion we will infer the maximum likelihood representation. So here we built a econometric model where the change in the interest rate on a discrete basis is given by a drift and by the shock, and the shock is governed by a normal process with a mean zero and a scaled variance. So the idea now with the maximum likelihood representation is to estimate A and B and sigma endogenously in the model. When we estimate with OLS, we first estimate A and B, and then manually we calculate the sigma. But with the ML, we can do everything at the same time. And I will show it here. First, I have calibrated a time series of data of 3 months LIBOR. This constitute a historic time series, the sample. And here I have the changes in the sample. So this is the sample version of the delta RT. Remember, this is the true model, and this is the sample that we take out of it. And then we have to estimate the parameters by ML. And what we do is to build not the OLS representation, but the ML representation for each observation. So simply estimating this one, the error cancels out because it's the estimated is the true. Now we have to estimate it, and we know the expected value of U is zero. You can see it in here. And we do that for all observations, which gives us a residual for all. And if it was OLS, we would simply square all these residuals and minimize it by changing A and B. And then afterwards we will calculate, as I said, manually the sigma. But now with the ML, we do it differently. We build a normal distribution for each observation. Where the observed variable is the difference, and the mean is zero, and the standard deviation is the parameter that we would like to estimate endogenously in the model. And we do that for everyone. And now the idea is to maximize this probability or this density, because this will maximize the chance that this will go to zero, because the mean is zero in the distribution. So the highest point in the normal distribution curve is where, in this case, the mean is zero, which is where we want to be. All these observations, they are independent. So if we take the product, it will get us the joint distribution. And if we maximize the joint distribution, we maximize the chance that we will get as close as possible for each observation to zero in the residual. So this is the idea, that we maximize the joint distribution of all these residuals. If I just calculate all these, just like if you calculate the chance of getting six sixes in a row with a die, then we'll get a horrible large number that perhaps even Excel will not be able to handle. So what we do is just to take the log, and if we take a log to a multiplicative series, we just sum them up afterwards. So we take the log to each of them and sum it. So this is the log likelihood estimate. And this will give us the same result when we optimize or maximize as if we did it when just building a number of the products of all these 36 observations. So what we have to do now is to maximize the log likelihood by changing the parameters in the drift and the volatility in the distribution. So here I have already fitted them, so I'll just make a disequilibrium so that we can see the optimization. Okay, I cannot hit the keyboard. So we have to use Excel's solver for doing this. So I go to data, go to solver, set objective target variable, which is U19. I want to maximize. Please remember, don't type minimize. This is what we do in the OLS when we minimize the squared residuals. Now we maximize likelihood by changing these three variables. And here I set a constraint on the standard deviation, because if Excel digs in negative territory to look for a solution, it types in a negative volatility, and the Excel sheet will blow up because you cannot divide by zero or by negative. So this is why I put a constraint on. It's not that there is a solution in the negative territory, but I want to avoid that the algorithm seeks for a solution in negative territory. And if you try this yourself, you will find out that Excel indeed does it. So let's estimate. It has converged. So convergence speed 155, mean reversion, so the long run average almost 5%. Volatility, and remember this is a monthly volatility in the expression we operate. In the model, we operate with annualized volatility. So according to the IID rules, I just squared with 12. Oh, I multiplied with the square root of 12 to get 2.14. Okay, so anyway, I can test if this is stupidly wrong or if it's okay, correct. What I can do is just to look at this series here, because this was not arbitrarily chosen. This was actually drawn from a Vasicek model. So, and I just copy pasted it. So the RAND function doesn't run all the time, but this was actually taken from a Vasicek simulation with these inputs. And as you see, they are not totally far away. This is per anno. So this is how we do it, and here you see the actual LIBOR and the estimated curve. And now this is very nice. Now we have a model for the short rate, which we can use to price all products with backwards induction, but we can also use it to price the entire yield curve. The only thing that we need to add is a market risk premium, which is a factor that Vasicek had to add on, because he couldn't use the same replication arguments that Black and Scholes made. They excluded all risk premia, because in the setting with bond pricing based on a rate, there's a problem, because the rate cannot be traded like a price of the underlying product. So this is why there is a risk premium, and I didn't estimate that in the model, so I just type it in here as a constant, and then I will apply the ugly Vasicek formula. At least at a first glance, they look ugly, but the more you look into it, it makes sense. But now with the parameterization, I can just move around with the curves. I have now simulated a new path of stochastic rates, and based on those rates, I can calibrate the entire yield curve at any point of time. Say for instance, 1 year ahead, I have calibrated a short rate of 7%, and this corresponds to all these zero coupon yields. And this is the blue curve up here. So this curve here is slightly inverse. Same I've done on Suya node, orange. So let's just give it some action. So I just push the F9 button to activate the rand function in Excel, which generates a new path of 40 periods, and you see how the blue and the yellow buttons here correspond to the short rate of 1 and 2 year ahead, and how the curve looks. Okay, I will just address the two big problems in the Vasicek model. So despite all its simplicity and intuition, there is first the problem of negative outcomes of the interest rates in the future because of the normal distribution feature, and we can see that quite easily because I have a high volatility. So you see here negative rates. You can also see here already. Here we have 16.6 minus. And the other problem is that all rates on the curve are perfectly correlated because there's only one driving factor, being the short rate. And this you can try to perhaps calculate yourself by differentiating the yield function differentiated with respect to RT, and you will see you are left with a linear function of RT, which means that all yields are perfectly correlated. They always move in the same relative size. All right, this was a long session, but hopefully you learned something from it. So with these words, I say thank you very much.